Good evening.
Friday evening, and you're spending it here. That is astonishing. Thank you for, thanks so much, Amy, for the introduction. And if you choose to, instead of listening to me, you can now go on the internet and make some more citations. So publish your thing quickly. And before the evening's out, we can have 50,000 citations. And that might qualify me even more to be a president of some university somewhere. This is it's a great honor, actually, to be invited to give this lecture as part of your lecture series. I want to thank everything that Amy's done for hosting this and really inviting me, being so invitational for bringing me here. I've known Amy and a number of you, actually, since I came in, and I just realised I see one again here, when I first came in 1997. And since then, extraordinary things have happened in Hong Kong and around the world, and we'll mention one or two of them this evening. And I also want to thank Stephen Andrews, who has apologised that he can't be all the way through the lecture this evening, because he has to fly back to Europe to solve the problems of Brexit, basically. good luck with that one, Stephen. This evening, what I would like to do is talk with you about this topic, Leading from the Middle. There are people here, presumably, who are members of faculty. If you're a member of faculty, could you raise your hand? Excellent. If you're a school principal, could you raise your hand? Or vice principal? If you're a teacher, could you raise your hand? Excellent. Just coming in. If you're a member of my family, could you raise your hand? Okay, good. So we have first of all, I have to put the computer back on here, because every so often it will decide that it wants to do this. There we go. So, among my family are this is a family who aren't here. But so my wife Pauline is here. This is our daughter Lucy, and her husband Jay, and Jackson, who's 4 years old, and who's looking slightly bemused by the relatively recent arrival in the family of the twins, Penelope and Amelia. And here with me this evening, with my wife, is our son, Stuart. Our son Stuart, and his wife, Laura Stuart, lives and works in Hong Kong now, as does Laura, and particularly pleased to have them, because they'll soon be, in a few months, by the time we arrive next time, there'll be a new grandchild in the family. And we don't have a picture of that grandchild yet, or perhaps there'll be two of them, like the twins and the other family. Who knows, really? So it's a lovely thing to know that that when I come back here over the next 2 years, that in a way, part of our family will be born here, and will be one of you, I think, as well as one of us. The topic I want to discuss, if you want to read about it. First of all, there will be a book on this, but it's not written yet. It will be written later this year, but if you want to read an article, this is probably the best place to go, which is this article in Phi Delta Kappa, and written with my colleague from England, who some of you may know, Mel Ainscough. So I'm going to do three things this evening. I'm going to talk for around the first half, about the big picture of educational change, and then just for a tiny little bit in the in In the central part of the talk, I'll talk about the little picture of educational change. There's a whole lecture on that, but we can do that another time when I'm back on another occasion. And then for the big other chunk, I'm going to talk about this the middle picture, which is leading from the middle that connects more than connects actually, but represents or embodies the first two. The traditional view of the role of the school principal for a long time was that really it was the job of the school leader or the system leader or the faculty leader actually to know and to understand the big picture of the organization. So big picture thinking, if ever you want a job as a principal or a system leader or a dean or a president, big picture thinking is part of what you're supposed to have. The leader's job was to know the big picture, and indeed sometimes as a school principal was to know it so the other people didn't have to, so they could get on with their job teaching in the classroom. In fact, in the old days, the job of the principal at their best was to be a kind of white knight in traditional British forms, who would protect the staff from the forces that were battering on the door of the school from the outside, from complaining parents, from helicopter parents, from difficult parents, from unreasonable policies, from rings of paper that would come into the school, and the principal would hold them back like a tidal wave so that the teacher could just think about their children and their classes and get on with their day-to-day work. The job of the teacher was the little picture, and the job of the principal was the big picture. And there was a difference between the two. But we're going to see how these two connect up in a fairly profound way this evening. So, to begin with the big picture. The big picture is changing, and I believe from the work I'm doing in different parts of the world now, both in terms of research and also advisory work, that we're in a kind of a transition from one age to another in educational change in many parts of the world. We have been since at least the mid-90s and definitely since the beginning of this century in an age of what I would call an age of achievement and effort. And in the age of achievement and effort, these have been the questions that we've been thinking about. How are we doing? How do we know? How do we measure it? How do we know if we're making progress? How can we improve? How can we get better over time? When I first came as Onmore Fellow in 1997, these were big questions in Hong Kong. People were wondering how to improve the quality of Hong Kong education when the medium of instruction in secondary schools was English and not all teachers wanted to or could or did have full competence in English as the medium of instruction, when there were concerns about getting the quality of teaching up and being able to recruit better people and retain better people in the profession in competition with other professions. You were in the very early stages of just thinking about partnerships between schools and universities. Do you remember this period in 1997? You were doing outstanding scholarly work, a world ranking work as you do now, but in terms of thinking about the school system when people came to Hong Kong, in a way people were thinking from outside, what are the problems with Hong Kong? How can we help them? Hong Kong sent school leaders and system leaders on courses to other countries to get advice and get help. And boy, has the tide changed. Because now if you look at the international PISA scores, where other countries wring their hands in wretched self-abnegation, in response to the lowly PISA scores that they have in relation to Singapore or Shanghai and now Hong Kong. We are coming to you. You're not coming to us. We, whoever we are, the rest of the world, we are coming to you. The rest of the world's been going to Singapore to want to know what the secret of the success of Singapore is, but now, here are your PISA results. You know all these. They're in the newspapers. You don't need me to remind you, except just a tiny bit. It's nice to know when you're doing well and have people to remind you on some areas how well you're doing. These are PISA scores in maths and in reading. Almost there, up with Singapore. So the question is, how are you going to spend the next few years? Are you going to try and drive yourselves to distraction and destruction to get 8 more points so that you can be equal to, or 9 more points so that you can be higher than Singapore? Is that what you're going to do? Is that how you will spend your time? Is that where you will put your energy? Part of that is thinking about also how can these results benefit everyone? And Hong Kong does quite well on that also, in fact very well compared to other nations. So this is the classic OECD, this is the classic OECD chart. And people are, from my family, this is what I hear, are waving at me implying that my microphone may not be working. So you've heard nothing of what I've been saying for the last 10 minutes. And you're all going yes, which means you have. So let me just try this. All right, 3 people have now left. Okay. Aha! Are we good? All right, thank you so much for that. So, so the best corner to be in here is the top corner. Top corner means high achievements, high equity. So the more you're in the top corner, the in terms of people who take the international PISA test, the less likelihood is that your background, your family of origin will affect the outcomes that you get in terms of public education or state education. All this should be familiar to you. Of course, to raise the PISA scores and other kinds of test scores in other countries, many sacrifices have had to be made. People have narrowed the curriculum. They have taught to the test. They've concentrated on students just below the cutoff score and given them a lot of extra attention, because a small gain for them will look like a big gain in the overall scores. You're familiar with these as well. These are called the perverse incentives of teaching to the test. But there's a good part of these results too, particularly on equity. So I'm not going to suggest this evening that we should leave behind the age of achievement, which is drive up standards, and equity, which is that they should benefit everyone, and that effort, which is we should try as hard as we can to get these, because in an age when social mobility is declining in many countries, the chance, whatever your background, that you can be mobile, that you can move up with hard work, effort and achievement, irrespective of family circumstances, and because of the effort of your teachers and communities, remains an extremely important part of what our work is about in public education. But now there's also a second set of questions that belong not just to Hong Kong, but to many other countries as well around the rest of the world. Last summer, my wife and I and 2 good friends were walking across northern England. What was remarkable about our day-to-day experiences was not so much the wild scenery, though that was glorious, but it was the even wilder stories that were in the press and the newspapers every breakfast time when we opened this up, because this was the first week of Brexit, of when a referendum in the United Kingdom had decided and been confirmed this week. All sets of questions about what relationship England and Scotland would have to the rest of Europe. And then in October I got on a plane, and when I got on the plane, everybody thought that next day we would be announcing that Hillary Rodham Clinton would be the next president of the United States. And when I got off the plane in the evening, that no longer appeared to be true. I'm afraid to travel anywhere else, because I'm beginning to think I could be causing this, whatever it is. But the questions that these things and other things are about are these questions. In an age of identity, engagement, and well-being, They are questions now also of who are we? Who are we? England, Europe, Americans, immigrants, Hong Kong, China, other nations. Who are we? Who are we? What will become of us in the future? Who will decide? Who are we? What will become of us? Who will decide? Now, some of the news about global changes that are affecting these sorts of questions is good news. So since the Millennium Development Goals were set in 2004, I think, Mark, you'll be able to remember better than I can, yeah, 2004, almost half a billion people around the world, by some measures, are now out of extreme poverty in terms of some of the worst things that humankind has to deal with. We're making progress in terms of some of the Millennium Development Goals. But if we look at people who are moving out of abject poverty, but also the rest of the world, the rest of society, we see at the same time that there are great inequities in terms of income, in terms of wealth. 62 people now own basically half the world's wealth. 62 people. And increasingly, the 1% within some of the most developed economies, like the UK and the US, but also across the world, have increasing concentrations of wealth that belong to them, that mainly do not trickle down to benefit other people, because there's only so many ways you can spend your money and so many people you can employ. Much of it is inherited or lost or locked up in various ways. And what are the results of that? Well, you'll know the Gini Index, which is an index of economic inequality. And in terms of economic inequality, Hong Kong, on the Gini Index, is the second most economically unequal country in the world, sandwiched between Lesotho and Honduras. There's probably almost no other indicator where you could put Hong Kong between those other two countries, but one of the most economically unequal in the world. And what does that mean when we look at it? Is it just a shame? Is it a pity? Is it unjust in some abstract sense? Well, when we get high inequality of income and wealth, other things pretty much tend to come along with that that affect the quality of life for adults and also for children. These are at the other end, by the way. So we know, for instance, that in terms of Wilkinson and Pickett's work, not Wilson Pickett, he's a soul singer from the 1960s, but in terms of Wilkinson and Pickett's work on the spirit level, if you look at this, they have many graphs and charts, but for them, the strongest predictor of quality of life or absence of quality of life in society is not overall levels of wealth, but beyond a basic minimum level of subsistence, the greatest predictor is economic inequality. And the more inequality you have, the worse the overall well-being is, which includes child well-being in a society. If you're looking for Hong Kong on here, it's not on their graph. But we can guess where Hong Kong might be from some other indicators. So announced the week before last, for example, were the international results on rankings of happiness. So here you see, again, the Northern European countries and Canada, which are the more economically equal, tend to rank better on indicators of happiness, multiple indicators. Hong Kong ranks 71, China ranks 79. And higher GDP will not get you more happiness. So over the last decade or so, GDP has increased in China by 500%. But happiness, according to these indicators, actually went down a little at first with the increases in GDP and has recovered a little. So it's gone down a little and recovered a little, whilst the GDP itself has been moving at a monumental rate forward for the society as a whole. So more GDP will not by itself get you more happiness. So a lot depends on what you do with the GDP and how it benefits everyone. So Norway, the happiest country in the world, everybody who retires will be a millionaire. Everybody who retires. So I can't wait, basically. So because it is really about how the wealth is spread and who it benefits, and who it's another kind of indicator of equity. So what are some of the things that across the world then our schools have to deal with? What is the big picture that is not just abstractly outside there, but that walks into people's classrooms every day? In other countries, we are facing probably the greatest refugee crisis for at least 50 years. At least 50 years. With a refugee crisis for countries who take in those refugees, and not all do to the same degree, but within that refugee crisis, the kinds of things that we witness are when refugees come into your schools, they don't just have language learning needs. They also have increasingly the effects of conflict, of violence, of up to 7 post-traumatic stress incidences. So coming into people's classrooms in other parts of the world are children whose parents have been killed in front of them, whose homes have been destroyed, who've never been to school, who've forcibly been removed from their community, or their friends, their countries. And they arrive in your classroom. And in Sweden, for example, last year, I sat down with senior people in the ministry. And what they said is, our main challenge at the moment is to find teachers for 30,000 unaccompanied children. 30,000 unaccompanied children. And the OECD is telling us we must raise our PISA scores. At one and the same time, these two things were true. There's also an epidemic of mental health problems across the world that are, we don't fully know the reasons for these, but this is from the UK. In an average class of 15-year-olds in the UK, these are the kinds of figures that you will get. So 7 are likely to have been bullied. 10 likely to have seen their parents separate. 3 could have a mental disorder. And then there's computers. So about 5 years ago, in the work I do in Canada and elsewhere, a question I'd often ask when I went into classrooms and schools would be, so what are you doing with technology in your school? And about 5 years ago, people would say things like, well, we can download really good content on the internet, we can access excellent YouTube videos and see examples of what we're doing, we can connect with students and teachers in other countries, we can access experts, we can get real-time feedback on our learning in the languages and see if we're progressing in terms of our abilities and our competence. This is not what people now say when you ask them the question, what is happening with technology in your school? The first thing that teachers will talk about in places like Canada, not just the United States, but Canada, is the distractibility of young people, how difficult they find it to focus and to concentrate. I'm amazed in Hong Kong, by the way, when in the school I've been fortunate to go to, how focused the children are in the school. When out of school, there are lines of people. There are lines of people walking down the street, like straight across you. They just walk. They don't even know you're there. They just go straight across you. And so I'm astonished that there's this kind of separation of this virtual world that people have when they're walking along, and the world in school where they seem able to focus. Because in Canada, teachers really worry that children are losing that capacity and becoming increasingly distractible, and spending on average 10 hours or more a day engaging with things on screens. And that this is doing something to the rewiring of their brains and their capacity to concentrate over time. And the third thing they worry about is cyberbullying, particularly girls by girls, causing, so girls across the world are experiencing increasing achievement and also increasing anxiety. More achievement and more anxiety at one and the same time. And sometimes in education we contribute to this anxiety. Here's the parents and the contribution they make. So here's a little slide from a school I was in yesterday. I can't say which school it is. But in class they were talking about the spoiled child syndrome. In Singapore they call this the strawberry generation. Easily spoiled, often bruised. Or perhaps it's often bruised, easily spoiled. One or the other. By the way, if you tried teaching this in America, parents would sue you. Because you'd be criticizing the parents in your curriculum, and they couldn't possibly have that. But sometimes in education we actively contribute to the ill-being of our children. Not the well-being, the ill-being of our children. I was with a group of principals yesterday, second-year principals, some of them may be here, and I asked them the question. I said, I'm going to mention a word in a second, and then I'm going to go around, and with no time for thinking, I want you to give me the first word that you think of. And I said the word, examination. And the words were stressed, fearful, stressed. Now, perhaps they didn't know any other words, but I don't think so. The overwhelming experience for the principals was feeling of stress. And if the principals are stressed, imagine how the students feel and how the you don't have to imagine, you know this every day. One of the results of an excessive focus on the necessities of the age of achievement and effort are consequences for engagement, identity, and well-being. And the problem is not confined to Hong Kong. It's in many other parts of the world. So even in Ontario, Canada, where we're doing our work, they don't rank schools in relation to each other. They don't publish the results of the tests in the newspaper. But they still have two tests every year in Form 3 and Form 6. And when we interview teachers and people in schools, these are the things that they say to us. And when we witness children on test prep, we see children who are performing very well in ordinary classes, regular classes, and as soon as they have to write down what they know rather than display it in other ways, they become anxious and distracted and start doodling or drawing pictures in the margins. So these are especially issues for Hong Kong, but they're really issues all over the world about the changing big picture of education. So how do we change the big picture? What are the ways that we can address it and approach it? Well, one thing we can do is we can change it from the top. We can have someone at the top, a supreme being, with their masterful thinking, who will decide what it is the rest of us need to do in order to change education. This person might have delusions of their own grandeur. This person might think they're capable of saving everybody else, and we'll look at an example of this in a second. But the truth is, the problems are now so complicated that no principal can know everything about everything. As one principal once said to me, I can't know everything about everything themselves. It's not possible for the person at the top to do it all. This is especially true if they are bad leaders. This is Barbara Kellerman's book on bad leadership. It's a great book. It's a business book and a social science book. And she says there are two kinds of bad leaders. First, there's the incompetent, ineffective leader. The leader who can't organize. The leader who can't follow through. The leader who is always late with everything. The leader who cannot inspire a single individual. A leader who drones on rather than dreams big. This kind of leader. But then there's a second kind of bad leader at the top. And this is the manipulative leader. This is the Pol Pot of genocide. The Peter the Great of Russia, who tortured his own children for the sheer pleasure of it. This is the Lady Macbeth of fiction, okay? These are the bad leaders, the evil leaders, the wicked leaders. These are leaders who are against things. Leaders who want to turn away other people. Leaders who promise to make you great again. Leaders, leaders, whoever they may be, leaders who want to go back, leaders who want to turn others away, leaders who want to build walls of time and space around themselves, safeguarding against an uncertain and diverse and different future. I asked people in a room like this, I've asked two rooms, we don't have time today, but if we had post-it notes, just to write down, you might want to try this in school sometimes, think of a bad leader you have known, preferably not someone in the room. and write down the ways that they exercise bad leadership. And in Singapore and in London, England, these were some of the things that they said about their bad leaders. Most of us sometime will do some of these things. So when you look at these, this is a moment to reflect. Do you get your teachers to run personal errands for you? Do you email them at the weekend and expect a reply? So you can email, but do you expect a reply at the same time? Do you hide in your office? Are you a slave driver? Do you scold your teachers on the intercom system that runs through the school? Which some of the people do that these school principals describe. So leadership at the top doesn't work when it's bad leadership, but it doesn't work when it's good leadership either, because not everything can be controlled from the top, especially when we look at certain aspects of the little picture now. So I'm going to take you past all these. So in the little picture, when we think about identity, engagement and well-being, if we want our children to be well, if we want them to be healthy, joyful, if we want our children not to kill themselves, or be depressed, or be too anxious, if we want them to be engaged and not disengaged with what they're doing in school, these are just data from America, but almost half of children are disengaged from the learning. They're learning, they may be achieving, but they're not engaging with what they're learning. And if you don't engage, it's less likely that you will remember later on what it is that you have been learning. So how do we get children to be engaged? I have a question for you to ask you. The question is this, and you're going to turn and talk for 2 minutes. If I was in the school I was in yesterday, they'd have said you'll turn and talk for 1 minute and 40 seconds. Because the evidence is if you give people a ridiculous number, they will pay attention to it. But if you say 2 minutes, they'll think it's really three. And if you say 5, they'll think it's really 10. So actually, I'll give you 1 minute and 50 seconds without going on Google and looking up the answer. This is like dinners used to be. Because one of the best things about teaching is not knowledge. It is ignorance. It is ignorance. It is that moment, that divine moment in teaching when nobody knows what the answer is going to be. And there's nothing you can look up that will tell you. So we all, for a moment, have to imagine or speculate or hypothesize. The great thing about teaching is not just knowledge, it is ignorance. So here is a divine moment of ignorance. And the question is a factual question. What was the first moment in history when the word engagement first appeared? What did engagement originally mean? And you have 1 minute, 40 seconds to talk without any digital device to talk to the person next to you. Okay, 20 seconds. 20 seconds left. Okay, I'm going to come around now. I'll not bring the microphone because I'm just going to ask for one word. I'm going to ask people for one word. If you can't think of a word, or you're shy, you just say pass, and I'll go to the next. Okay? I'll just go to the next. And I'll see that everybody's going to pass here. But if other people can't hear, I'll repeat the word that you say. Okay? So the first use of engagement was in relation to what? Was in relation to cognition. Was in relation to involvement, was in relation to marriage, okay, marriage, yeah, was in relation to interest, and I'll take one more, was in relation to, yeah,
war,
okay, you're going to find the answer in about 2 minutes. So, when you get kids in your class and you want them to be engaged, the first kind of kid with a bit of luck you really hope for is this kind of kid. This is me as a child. Okay? That's my mum, and my dad's taking the picture. So, you know, there are some people, they're just engaged the moment they're born. They come out of the womb. They're like this. Hello, I'm engaged. And when you teach them, it's fantastic. They're enthusiastic about everything. When you're teaching a lesson and you ask for somebody to participate, they go, let me try, let me try, let me try. Okay? And they're the same ones, and you call on them over and over again. And you just love having, and when they're children, it's fantastic. When they're adolescents, they drive their friends crazy. Because it's so uncool to look like this when you're an adolescent, okay? Especially a boy. Sometimes they just continue to be like that. This is me a few years ago. So some people don't change. They're engaged when they're born. They're engaged when they start thinking about retirement. They've been engaged all the way through. But the rest of the time, and you're lucky if your children come into class already engaged and ready for you and interested and curious. But engagement and motivation are a condition for learning. They're the outcome of learning. Engagement and motivation are achievements. Engagement and motivation for you as teachers are, you're lucky if they're engaged and motivated, and you complain if they're not. It is your responsibility for learners to become engaged and motivated. That's one of the hardest things to do. And you can't do that by leading from the top. And to understand that, you have to understand the meaning of engagement. And the clue is in the origins of the term engagement. In the 16th century, the first use of the word engagement was in the context of war and battle. Engagement wasn't fun. Engagement was about enjoyment. Engagement wasn't about cute activities. Engagement wasn't Hello Kitty. Engagement wasn't a little competition to see who could get the most marks. Engagement was serious. Engagement was focused. Your life depended on being engaged. You paid attention to nothing else other than the enemy that was coming towards you. You were in a very different way than Malcolmship Mahaile meant it. You're in a moment of flow, which is absolutely concentrating on what it was that your life would depend on. And then a century later, engagement then became used in the context of marriage, which is also, I'm very careful because my family are with me, which is also not always fun, but absolutely serious and important. Engagement is a promise to be married. A promise to be married in sickness and in health, for better or for worse, and like battle, until death us do part. There's only one tiny difference between the word marital and the word martial. They are more alike than they are unlike in many respects, and I may have a difficult dinner to follow as a result of this. But it's important to understand, therefore, that and that the challenge is greater explaining this to, say, American teachers, that engagement isn't always fun. Engagement isn't always cute. Engagement isn't always noisy. Sometimes engagement is quiet, like Buddhist engagement, or meditation, or prayer. Engagement can take many different forms. I've got another lecture in this. The point tonight is, if engagement is part of the little picture of change, when children have digital distractions, when children come into school with multiple post-traumatic stresses, when children may have mental health problems, and then your job is still to get them engaged, how can we do this? We can't do it all from the top down, and we can't do it all from the bottom up with the weight of the world upon our own shoulders just through sacrifice by itself. Because then we will have child well-being, but no teacher well-being. And a teacher who is burned out or dead wood is not a teacher who can help anybody at all. So how do we get a better little picture of educational change in the context of this big picture? And the answer is to lead from the middle. And we're going to have another little interaction now. And so are you ready? So this time I'll ask you to turn in a moment either to somebody behind or somebody in front, okay? So not side to side, but somebody behind or somebody in front. And this time it is in 1 minute, with hands off devices, to think of all the phrases you can think of in English with the word middle in them. So, and you can't use education as an example. All the phrases you can think of in 1 minute with the word middle in them. Are you ready? Go. Here we go. ready. We're ready. So just one example from different, we'll take a whole bunch. So. This may mean different things in different cultures, but his answer was middle finger. Okay. So, middle finger, the lady in the middle here. The lady in the middle. Sorry? Up and down. Okay, but no, it has to have the word middle in it. Okay, so the middle is between up and down. Middle school. Middle school. Yeah, lady here.
Middle class.
Middle management. Middle age. Middle age spread. Middleman. Okay. What are all these phrases have in common? Yeah, they're kind of they're either negative. All right. So, you know, middle age spread, middle school, which is the thing you want to get through, like puberty, and come out the other side. Middle kingdom, middle earth, middle America. All these things, middle management, they're either negative things, or they're things that have no identity of their own. Or they're things where you get lost, like middle child. We stopped at two children so that our second child would never end up being a middle child. Okay? Actually, that's not the reason, but it sounds like a good reason. So they're either negative, or middle has no identity of its own. It is simply something that connects the other two. And yet, if you hear the words leading in the middle, or middle-level leadership, or middle leadership. Is this familiar to anyone? When you talk about your middle level or your middle management? Yeah? So what we usually think of here is leading in the middle. And leading in the middle has been used in the last few years by people like Andreas Schleicher from the OECD, who's in charge of the PISA scores, or Sir Michael Barber, until recently chief advisor for Pearson, and before that in McKinsey, who did the reports on different countries worldwide. And for them, the idea of leading in the middle is the notion of a middle level or a middle tier. And the purpose of it is to implement things at the top so that schools will do them at the bottom. So it's a hierarchical model. It's a model of levels. So sometimes when people think about middle tier or middle management, they're thinking of people who will do the work at the top for them, so it will get done by people who are the teachers at the bottom. The worst way of thinking about this is a principal sits in their office and thinks, what is a horrible, repugnant job that I don't want to do? And let me delegate it to other people, and I'll call it a leadership opportunity for them. And this is the worst sense of middle-level leadership. It's a way of getting implementation done. Or, if you're beginning changes at the bottom and innovations, it's a way of trying to cluster them together and give them some sort of coherence. But this is not what I mean, and it's not just me, but the teachers I will talk about in a second, mean by leading in the middle. Leading in the middle is a geological metaphor, or a mechanical metaphor. Leading from the middle is more of an organic metaphor. It is the heart of leadership. The things that we truly care about. It is the spine of leadership that holds it together and gives it integrity. It is the guts and the courage of leadership and it is the goal and the daring to make a difference together. Leading from the middle is not about the changes that we implement. It's about the changes that we begin and that we, the most of us, are responsible for. And the next few minutes may not hold together quite as coherently as the minutes that have come, because this is new and it's not written yet, but roughly it looks like this. In 2009 to 2011, my colleague Henry Brown and I at Boston College were asked to do an evaluation of a major educational reform in the province of Ontario in Canada, which is almost as high performing as Hong Kong and almost as equitable. Actually, it's in the same quadrant as Hong Kong. And the reform was a reform in special education inclusion. So, as you're beginning to think about in Hong Kong now, it was how children with special educational needs could, more of them, would be in regular classes. And more than that, how the specialists who were responsible for children with special educational needs would work alongside teachers in ordinary classes rather than pull the children out to go somewhere else, and what the relationship would be like between them. And then at the ministry level, how the special education staff would work in partnership in an integrated way with the curriculum staff. What was set at the top, because the middle still needs a top, was not a detailed policy that the middle then had to implement, but a philosophy. And the philosophy was very simple, and it was this, very inspiring. What is essential for some children is good for all children. What is essential for some of us is good for all of us. So, for instance, when we have televisions where you can read the text as well as hear the sound, it's not just good for people who have an impairment or a disability. It's good for me when I go to the gym and I haven't taken any digital hearing device and I want to read the news on CNN and it's coming across at the bottom. What is essential for some people is good for all people. So instead of designing a curriculum and then saying, how do we adjust it for children with special educational needs? The question was to follow the principles of what is called universal design in architecture. And that is, not how do we design a building and then modify it for people who are blind or people who are in wheelchairs, but how at the moment we design the building do we think, what is the maximum possible use of this building and enjoyment for the majority of people, for old people, for parents with strollers, with young children in them? How from the moment we design it do we think, how does this include the vast majority? And then the major place to deal with the question of children with special educational needs is in the classroom with differentiated teaching and learning, not standardized teaching in the classroom, or even three groups in the classroom, and then another class for children with disabilities. But the capacity to differentiate your teaching and learning in every classroom for all the students. And while that is good for students with severe disabilities and impairments, that's good for all students, because all students, in fundamental respects, also differ in the ways they learn, the ways they access knowledge, and the ways in which they can display their knowledge. What is essential for some people is good for all people. And the question was how did a government implement that philosophy? Now, one thing it could have done was given a mandate and told, thrown children into teachers' regular classrooms, given them no support, and then said, get on with it, good luck, with no resources. That's top down. And it's probably bad top down rather than good top down. But instead, what they did was they said, this is the philosophy. In Ontario, you have 72 school districts for 13 million people. And we will give these school districts for 1 year in the first instance, people thought it was just 1 year, $25 million to make a one-time change that will last forever. And what the districts decided to do was this, and that they didn't really know what they were doing. They asked us to come and study what they were doing so they could explain it to other people. But essentially, this is what they did. First, they recognized all districts were different. Their students were different. Some had mainly immigrant students. Some had mainly indigenous students. First Nation, what were called First Nations, Métis, Inuit, in particularly northern Canada, northern Ontario. Some had Old Order Christian Mennonite students who were like the Amish in America and have one book in the home and no other books. Some were poor white working class. The districts differed, so their view was children differ. Districts differ. You cannot have the same response for all districts. They have to have flexibility to respond in their own ways. But the districts must work together. Whatever their strategy is, their responsibility is to share it with other districts and indeed to help other districts who are struggling in areas where they are doing well. In another book that I've not showed you tonight that we did recently where we looked at unusually high-performing organizations that do better than the people around them. And we looked at this in business and in sport as well as education. The most high-performing could collaborate with their competitors. The people they compete with are people they also collaborate with. So as a slightly controversial item, nobody officially knows what band schools are in here, I believe, but everybody unofficially knows what band your public schools are in, correct? Yeah. Correct?
Yeah.
Unofficially, as the Leonard Cohen song says, everybody knows, all right? And the difficulty is if schools compete with each other, it's a disadvantage for every school. Because the goal of public education, private education has a right to exist. I work in a private university. They have rights to exist. But one goal of public education should be that public education is so good and so strong that the people who go to private education go not because they think it's better in some absolute sense, but because they think it offers something different or special as a direction or a value or a focus that the public system doesn't offer in the same way. But when schools collaborate with schools rather than compete with schools, even in fact if and when they compete, all public schools should and will get better over time. And people will make their private choices based on values and direction, not based on standards and on quality. Are you with me so far? So the first thing is all the districts, so think of yourself as a school. All the districts are diverse, like all the schools are diverse. But it's the responsibility of the schools to share what they do with other schools, to give help and to receive help. It's very important you do both. Very important you do both. And also to be responsible for each other's results. So the Hong Kong phrase is sharing, just like the Singapore phrase is sharing. The value of sharing is very important, but collective responsibility is more about sharing. It is more than sharing and talking. It's about doing, and as the last line shows here, it's about seeing what the results are for yourself and for other people, and taking responsibility collectively for those shared results. Are you with me so far? And I'm merely theorising what they did. And then, in the government of Ontario, I'm an advisor for the Premier of Ontario, Kathleen Wynne. There are four of us who are advisors. And in one of our meetings, people said in the system, they said, you know, our teachers and principals are complaining there are too many initiatives that they have to deal with. Hands up if you're in a school and you think that sometimes there are too many initiatives. Okay, what I should say is, close your eyes and put your hands up if you think there are too many initiatives. All right? So before the meeting, I wrote a short note to everybody, because I'm an advisor. And I said, here are several reasons why people think there are too many initiatives. Number one, there are too many initiatives. We have to take that seriously. Number two, the initiatives aren't joined up. Nobody has a story or a narrative that everybody can understand of how the initiatives are connected. So they seem like they have no relationship to each other. By the way, one of the jobs of the principal is to tell that story and narrative of how the initiatives are connected to each other and to you and to your core purpose. Three is the initiatives come from different departments in the bureau or in the government. So the government needs to be more joined up, as well as the schools being more joined up. And number four is at the government level and at the school level, the leadership needs to create an environment where people can take initiative or seize initiative or exercise initiative, where they can start change, begin change, commence change, be responsible for change, and not wait for changes to come from other people. And in leading from the middle, it's not about implementing other people's changes, but it's about starting and initiating changes yourself, together with other people. And leadership at the top creates an inspiring and enabling environment where more of that can happen over time. But when you do all that as a school or as a system, you don't neglect what are the priorities of the system and of the government. You pay attention to those, you are respectful of those, and wherever you can, you integrate what you do together with what is a direction or a priority or a focus of the system as a whole. This is what people describe to us, and two or three people in the system said, this is what we call leading from the middle. Leading from the middle is not my idea, it's their idea. Most of the good ideas of scholars begin in one or two places. Either they begin in a laboratory with rats, and they're the cognitive scientists and the neuroscientists, or they begin in a classroom with a real teacher who's making a change of importance, and then it ends up in our work. But it begins in the, and our job is we can be advocates for it and ambassadors of it. That's our skill, our gift, and our platform. But the integrity of the idea often begins in schools themselves, as this did. And so then, a couple of years ago, they asked us at Boston College back to say, how are we doing? And what does leading from the middle look like in practice? And what happened was we took their idea, we called it, we echoed leading from the middle, we wrote about it in the way that they understood. Now it comes back to them like a boomerang from us as leading from the middle. And what do these infernal teachers do and schools? They begin to give it a whole set of other meanings of their own than the one that we have written about. I'm being ironic, by the way, when I say that. Okay? So this is our research team. My colleague, Dennis Shirley, Chris Bacon, Mark D'Angelo, Shanae Wangi, and that's me. That's me at the end on a lake in southern Ontario. What what people meant by leading from the middle was four things. For some people, leading from the middle, of the weakest sense of the term, is just a set of specialist roles. In one school district, leading from the middle was the hearing specialist, or the curriculum consultant, or the coach or the mentor who would go around between different schools and connect the schools to each other. The other three meanings are more interesting. For some people, it was a philosophy. So here's what they said in a school district. I don't see it as connected to personnel. I see leading from the middle, if you like, the heart, the soul, the spine, the guts of leadership and learning, as a concept or a philosophy or a principle of wanting to get as close to the action as you possibly can. That's leading from the middle for them. For some other people, leading from the middle was a set of roles and specialisms, but now it was people working together in support of that kind of philosophy. The special education people, the curriculum people, the hearing specialists, the mental health specialists. So in one district, whenever a child struggled within a school, all the specialists would come together to figure out how to help them, instead of sending them to this person, or that person, or another person. Think about how this works in your school, whenever a child. Do you bring everybody together who knows something about the child in order to help the child? Or do you send them to a specialist who is supposed to help and care for them separate from the rest of the staff? I don't read out all the quotes, by the way, so when you listen to me, if you read at the same time, it stops you having to listen to me all the time, because you can read this as well. And then in some schools and districts, ultimately what they see is that at the middle is the child. At the middle is the child. So one school, for example, took the issue of Syrian refugees so seriously that the school worked together to raise $30,000 to bring a Syrian refugee family into Canada. And this was a collective responsibility of all the students with their teachers. The students were part of the middle, as well as the teachers being part of the middle. Very often we see at the best that it's the teachers who make the change, but our students are the objects of the change. In these schools, in some of the schools, the students are part of the change. They're participants in the change. They're agents of the change, as well as objects of the change. In another school, actually in the schools across the whole district, as an exercise, a little like lesson study here, but a different kind of exercise, and I'm anxious about saying this because some people might take the idea away with them. What they would do is they would concentrate on a child of wonder. So they would choose a child within the school who they wondered about and who they thought in their own way was a wondrous child. And they'd ask questions like these about the child. Now obviously they couldn't do this with every child in the school, but the exercise was to get in some cases 14 people in different roles, with different responsibilities, responsible for different forms, to think, what do they know about this child that can help them understand the child better and provide for their success and achievement? So it's a device to help people think together, take collective responsibility, and initiate changes that will benefit not only that child, but benefit all children. Where is the middle? The middle is wherever you are. Sometimes the middle is in a school. So, in this school in the north of Canada, they had a thing called a professional learning community. If you've heard the words professional learning community, could you raise your hand? All right, a lot. They're all over the world. In this school, as in the rest of the district, for many years, professional learning communities have been run by the principal on issues that the principal decided were important. And teachers would meet together as a team to focus on making improvements in the area that the principal had decided. In this school in the north, they found indigenous students who were suffered very severe difficulties, including what's known as fetal alcohol syndrome, which means their mothers were drinking alcohol while they were in the womb. And this negatively affects many cognitive processes and abilities to concentrate. They found two things. They found that children who couldn't achieve in the classroom, when they put them on a hockey rink, an ice hockey rink, with an ice hockey program, became highly successful and became leaders on the rink when they were never leaders in the classroom. So a group of teachers told the principal, instead of you running the professional learning community, we'd like to run one with the physical education teachers and the classroom teachers to figure out what are the skills that these kids are learning on the hockey rink that they can transfer into the regular classroom so that they can be successful in other areas of achievement. And one interesting insight that came up from this was in the classroom, the children can't sit still for more than a few minutes. So at first they put into the classroom a kitchen where they could do practical work, make scones and cakes and do other things. But the children literally climbed the walls of the kitchen cabinets. So thinking together as they did how to transfer skills and how to deal with the children as they are, not the children as they want them to be, in the classroom, they put a climbing wall. In the classroom. And so now, when the children need to climb the walls, they go climb the walls. And there's a rubber mat underneath so nobody dies or gets hurt. They climb for a few minutes, and after they've climbed, they're ready to sit down and concentrate for another 10 or 15. As a professional learning community of teachers, not the principal, they resolve this incredible problem by starting from the premise, we deal with the children as they are and we move them forward. They come to us as they come to us and we move them forward together. If they need to climb, we'll find a way for them to climb and that will also create space for them to learn in other ways. Sometimes leading from the middle is the group of teachers and students in your school. Sometimes it's across schools. So we're nearly done now, in case you're wondering where the time is going. But sometimes it's across schools. And we're working with a network of schools in the Pacific Northwest who are poor, you have no concept of this in Hong Kong, but they are poor, isolated, rural schools who are sometimes 2 hours away from the nearest highway, never mind the nearest school. So when you teach in your school with very challenged students, you might be the only teacher in Form 3, and you never have another teacher to talk about your curriculum with. And so our job has been to help them create a network where twice a year the teachers meet, and the rest of the time they communicate online with each other to plan and develop curriculum for the kinds of children that they have in common. And the goal of this is to increase student engagement with their learning and with their community. And the kind of things that the teachers have done now by working, once we created this platform so they could drive change together, is, for instance, a group of students in Alaska will make a time-lapse video for one day of their community. And they will send it to a community of potato farmers in Idaho, in the north of mainland, the mainland of other 49 states of America. And what this does is two things. It gives them greater pride in their own community that they used to think had no value or importance. And it gives them awareness of other communities at the same time. Pride in your own community and awareness of other communities and way of life. That the best collaboration was done with the students, with the students at the center, and with a group of teachers together driving change that benefited all the schools across the network. So sometimes leading from the middle is a group of schools, not just the staff within a single school. And last of all, so you know, I try to pay attention to this as well, is sometimes you have to do this across the world. So countries this week, right now, so I should be right now at this minute, not here, but in Scotland. And where I should be in Scotland is with the OECD, who convene an annual summit, the International Summit on the Teaching Profession, with the ministers and teacher union leaders of about 15 different countries. And the agenda is set by the OECD in collaboration with the unions. But it means there are certain things that these countries can't talk about. And it means you have to sit with other ministers, actually you may not like very much, on whose country's policies you don't agree with. 18 months ago, I set up with a colleague in Norway a group of seven countries, two states in one country, the US, to create a thing called the Atlantic Rim. These are countries around, so if you go on websites, there's a million websites with Pacific Rim. The only thing with Atlantic Rim on it is a monster movie. There's nothing else called Atlantic Rim, because people think Atlantic Rim is old Europeans with dead values. And Pacific Rim is where all the excitement is. So the counterintuitive thing is to create a network of Atlantic Rim countries, because those countries are changing rapidly because of issues like refugees and migration and so on. And their core values are things like inclusion, well-being, democracy, human rights, and around a core set of values that the countries are in agreement about together and want to advance. They help and support, network with each other, and also coach each other on how to move their policies forward. And over time, it is our goal to include countries from other regions that want to join this system of values, driven by the eight, if they are also sympathetic to them. So the geography is an accident. It's the idea that's important. Leading from the middle can be in your school. Leading from the middle can be across your schools. Leading from the middle can even be in the world. When we teach, every person matters. Every moment matters. Every second matters. The most successful sports teams score often in the last few minutes of the game. They don't stop playing. They're playing till the last minute. Most climbing accidents happen not on the way up, but on the way down, because people think they've stopped climbing, and they haven't. In teaching, as in life, all your minutes matter, even Friday afternoons. Even Friday evenings. The things that all of you will remember are your first classes that you taught and the last classes that you teach before you retire or move on or decide to do something else. One of the things in teaching is the importance of time, that every second, every minute counts. Never stop teaching. You never know what impact it can have on other people. But however hard you work, however much you sacrifice, you cannot, as a teacher or as a principal, do it all by yourself. From the bottom up, you cannot bear the weight of the whole world on your shoulders. And from the top down, you cannot be a supreme godlike creature who will successfully save the world and make your school or country great again. Bottom up isn't enough. top down is usually too much. What I've been trying to say tonight is that the answer is actually to work together. And there are two people who can help us think about this. One, what belongs to you, to many of you here. What belongs to you? And it's this hard thing when you see something you like in other people, you should emulate it. And the very difficult thing is when you see something you don't like in another leader or their followers, the really hard question is, how are we responsible for this? How are we responsible for the leaders we don't like or agree with coming into power? What contribution did we make? When those followers were children, who were their teachers and what did they learn? Who will be the leaders and followers of the future? And how will we educate them to be scientists, to be school teachers, and to be citizens? And some of this will be hard, because sometimes we're in a place of light, and sometimes we feel we're in a place of darkness. But as Helen Keller, the great writer, said, his work was about visual impairment. Walking with a friend in the dark is better, even when it's dark. Walking with a friend in the dark is better than walking alone in the light. Don't bear the world upon your shoulders. Don't be the supreme God who can save everybody single-handedly. Don't work with other people just to implement what those at the top decide. But drive change. Initiate change. Be collectively responsible for everybody's success. Lead together. Lead from the middle. It's the best way to be. Thank you for listening.